The Cloverfield movieverse has now officially expanded into some wild new territory. Netflix surprised fans of the sci-fi film series by dropping the third installment, The Cloverfield Paradox, on Super Bowl Sunday without warning. Like the first two films, Cloverfield 3 offers a new perspective on why all those giant monsters have appeared on Earth. If you haven't seen it yet, you might want to click away now because we're about to take a deep dive into outer space. Still with us? Good. The film centers on an International Space Station crew who are tasked with trying to solve the world's ongoing energy crisis by testing a particle accelerator known as the Shepherd. The mission is critical, as widespread starvation and world wars threaten to break out on Earth. The crew's Miracle Machine launch doesn't quite go as planned, though, as it sends the whole ship to another dimension. So, how does the film tie everything together, and what Easter eggs can be found floating throughout the space module? Let's take a look. The obligatory Kelvin nod. As the biggest named producer of all three films, J.J. Abrams was free to sprinkle in tons of references to his own life and previous works. Fans of Abrams may recognize the name of the gas station that Ava Hamilton and her husband Michael are waiting on line for at the beginning of the movie. It's called Kelvin, which is a brand that's appeared in a ton of Abrams' prior projects. It was the name of the man who occupied the hatch in Lost. It was the name of a spaceship in Star Trek, and even Star Wars The Force Awakens included a place called Kelvin Ridge. The name is a nod to Abrams' grandfather, Henry Kelvin, who was very influential to his interest in movies. The Kelvin gas station logo previously appeared in a scene from 10 Cloverfield Lane, so it also makes sense to include it here for continuity's sake. And that's not the only bit of brand loyalty Abrams snuck into the pick either. The Slusho connection. Another common thread found in most J.J. Abrams projects is Slusho, a fictional brand of ice drinks that seems to pop up everywhere in Abrams' universe, from his hit small screen series Alias and Fringe to Star Trek. It also appears in the first Cloverfield film. Jason Hawkins sports a shirt with the logo as an homage to his brother Rob's new gig with the company, but their hand in the havoc that levels the planet might be heavier than fans anticipated. According to the in-universe lore, the brand is owned by a Japanese mining company called Taguato, which is heavily featured in the Cloverfield alternate reality game, and is said to have set up offshore oil rigs throughout the world. The company name is also listed on a letter sent to Howard Stambler in 10 Cloverfield Lane, which led some Easter egg hunters to believe their drilling platforms might have opened up some kind of conduit for the original monsters to emerge through. Digital materials later revealed during the run-up for 10 Cloverfield Lane offered details of Stambler's job working with satellites and the company's satellite launch, which detail-oriented fans suspected had gone south and opened up the floodgates of monsters. However, the events of the Cloverfield Paradox seemed to challenge the long-held notion that a satellite failure started this whole thing. Alternatively, the presence of a Slusho bobblehead doll in the spaceship, along with a sighting of the actual company logo on board, suggests that Taguato has also been funding the Shepherd project. So that means, yes, they're still totally responsible for all of this, just not in the way people thought. In the last shot of Cloverfield, the original movie, there appears to be a falling… something? Perhaps that's the escape pod seen at the end of the Cloverfield Paradox? A brotherly bond? Another common thread the Cloverfield Paradox weaves with the previous sequel is the last name of another conspiracy theorist showcased in the movie, Mark Stambler. Yes, Stambler is the last name of John Goodman's character in 10 Cloverfield Lane, and he too seems to have some advanced knowledge of the hellfire that would rain down on Earth. Mark Stambler is seen giving a news interview about his book, which shares a title with this movie, and promoting his Twitter handle, Paradox is Real, which is also real, albeit inactive.
This experiment could unleash chaos.
Some suspect the two characters might be related, or even brothers, as it's certainly no coincidence they are equally impassioned about their beliefs in this end-of-days event. Howard Stambler's bunker guest slash prisoner Emmett even makes fun of him in 10 Cloverfield Lane by poking fun at his theory about mutant space worms. That joke becomes all too real in Paradox when our Russian comrade Volkov gets eaten from the inside out after the ship's earthworms are teleported into his body during the accidental dimensional hop. A familiar face. If the connection between the Stamblers wasn't clear enough, there's an even closer connection drawn between them by way of actress Suzanne Cryer. In The Cloverfield Paradox, she portrays a broadcast journalist who's seen interviewing Mark Stambler, and if she looks familiar, there's a reason. She also appears briefly in 10 Cloverfield Lane, as the injured woman who's desperately trying to gain entry into Howard Stambler's bunker.
To clarify, you believe their efforts to solve the energy crisis might unleash demons.
She's begging me!
Do not let her in!
Too bad she didn't listen to a special guest that day, huh? A mama monster? In unearthed production notes for the first film, J.J. Abrams, director Matt Reeves, and screenwriter Drew Goddard talked about the theories and themes that went into the film, and Abrams made an interesting comment about the monster. "He's a baby, he's brand new, he's confused, disoriented, and irritable, and he's been down there in the water for thousands and thousands of years." Given that Clover could level a skyscraper without even flexing, it might have been hard for fans to conceive of this creature as anything even remotely resembling a baby, but the final shot of the Cloverfield Paradox makes that very possible now. Whereas Cloverfield's Manhattan-shredding monster was as big as any building on the island, the monster that's shown ripping through the clouds in the final scene looks to be as big as some small countries, which means they've either opened another dimension of craziness with that second Shepard overload, or Clover's mother has come out to play now too. Foreshadowing Part 4? Mark Stambler's words during his on-air interview should have been more harrowing to everyone who watched, especially those on the space station. However, they tuned him out and got right to the job of doing exactly what he was warning against because, in their minds, the mission of solving the world's energy crisis was far more pressing than reading his promoted book to see if he was making any sense. But one thing he did say that, in retrospect, seems important is how wide-reaching the interdimensional warps of the Shepard would be. He told the reporter,
"They risk ripping open the membrane of space-time, smashing together multiple dimensions, shattering reality in the past, in the future, in other dimensions."
That certainly gives the Cloverfield movie universe a limited room to grow, and Movie 4, Overlord, is expected to center on a World War II-era encounter involving American paratroopers and a Nazi-occupied village. Stambler's suggestion that the past could be affected by their space flub seems like a clever way of keeping the film in the Cloverfield universe too, despite hopping back in time a few decades. Thanks for watching. Click the Looper icon to subscribe to our YouTube channel. Plus, check out all this cool stuff we know you'll love too.